Hello, everybody. This is my first, I want to say this is my first YouTube post ever, I think, that I've constructed on my own without the help of management or a label. So, I hope that the quality is good and that the content is splendid and that you enjoy it. Basically, what I'm going to be doing leading up to the beginning of our tour and possibly into the tour is answering questions from Twitter concerning the tour or our rarities collection or possibly just anything you have on your mind that you've been wanting to ask me. So I'm going to do a few, and I decided to be lazy and literally read them off my phone as I make the video instead of doing any work. So I hope you guys appreciate the laziness that I'm putting into this. Someone asked me, Claire Mastin is her name, asked me how many songs from each album we're playing. Again, I said I didn't want to give away the set list, but we're definitely playing, I think, at least two or three songs from all the actual official records. More in some cases. But half the set is made up of songs from the early Rarities collection. So it's about, I think, eight and eight, or maybe eight and nine, split in half between actual Say Anything songs and the rare stuff, the older stuff. So, should be a fun set. We're kind of interspersing them and messing around with them and stuff like that. Someone, Derek Richard, asked me, how do I remember every detail from every song I've ever written? So I'm assuming you're asking about lyrics. And actually, I have a weird thing with lyrics, which is that I have like a muscle memory from singing the song so many times. But if I go long enough without singing a song, I sort of develop like an anxiety complex about it. And then even though I technically know it and it's embedded in my brain really deeply, if I get on stage and I'm super nervous, I go into these phases where I'm like super aware of every single word, and I'm like almost have to sometimes I write down certain phrases that I know I'm gonna forget. Like, for instance, the second verse of Alive with the Glory of Love, which is a song I've sang arguably more than any other Say Anything song. For some reason, I have like an anxiety complex associated with the second verse. So you'll often see on our set list that I write the first couple of words when our city. See, I remembered it now, but like up there, it gets scary and then I forget. So let's take a look here. Let's peruse. Perusing. How has your life changed since becoming a dad? It's filled with this kind of existential joy that you can never really know until you have a child. Not to degrade anyone's experience who chooses not to have children or doesn't have them yet, but I mean, you can't deny that once they come into your life, it's this like profound experience of looking at this life you've created and that you now have the responsibility of taking care of and making sure they have an amazing life. And that obviously just shifts everything because it's no longer just about you. Even if you're married and you care about your spouse, it's a different thing when there's this tiny helpless creature that you are their only source of information and well-being and everything. So it's you can't help but have this huge, see, look right there. How can you look at that? For instance, Sherry's doing a kind of dangerous maneuver right there, kind of careless with the baby. And she's probably feels guilty about that, especially now that I've called her out. So that's the main change. And one of the things that I found was like a lot of parents were sort of naysaying the experience in terms of like, you're never gonna have free time, like your life is over. And I found that I actually have more free time because I kind of appreciate my free time more rather than just kind of listlessly looking on the internet at things I don't even want to look at. I'm like, okay, free time, do something cool. So I find that it doesn't feel like I have less free time. And often it's really fun just to stare at the baby and hold it or change its diaper. It's non-gender baby. Why did you dye your hair? from Renee. I don't know. It's something that I guess I wanted to do when I was like 12 years old, but I was too scared. So I figured now at this point where I no longer really care as much what I look like, it would be kind of fun because I've never done anything to my hair. It's always been boring brown. So, and also my wife has crazy colored hair all the time. So I thought it would be fun to let her do it. And I love it, actually. So, whatever. What Say Anything song is the most difficult for you to perform live? I would say Admit It is probably the hardest one, not only because there's so many words that I have to remember, which again goes back to the muscle memory thing. Like, I actually know those words pretty well, especially when we rehearse enough. But we usually play it towards the end of the set. It doesn't really make sense anywhere else in the set. So by the time we get to that, you know, we've already played probably a decent amount of, you know, taxing songs. And I kind of have to, like, get this second wind to make that song special. Yeah, I usually sometimes feel like I'm about to pass out or just, like, I don't even know how I exist sometimes towards the end of that song. And you end up kind of pushing yourself towards this sort of physical place that's beyond, you know, what you believe is your capability, and I'm just sweating and I'm not in shape. So that doesn't help. I'll do a couple more of these. Let's see. Okay, because Sherry's in the room, I'll take this question, which I wouldn't have taken if she wasn't. I'm just kidding. This is from Shay. It says, what did S. Dupree Bemis do that made you fall in love with her? Do you have any advice on how to love after you've been hurt? I think it's very important for anyone who gets into a relationship to have, like, a really organic connection and give it time. Like, I think people are either usually afraid of intimacy or they're kind of rushing at it with, you know, too much focus, and then it kind of obscures their view of the other person, and then they get caught in a relationship they don't want to be in, which obviously I've been on both ends of that spectrum, and I think it's a lot of it has to do with the place you're at, and that sort of leads you intuitively to find a person who you actually, like, click with in such a deep way where you're not forcing anything, and that's kind of what me and Sherry had and still have, and that's why we gravitated toward each other. We actually, like, met emailing each other. It was kind of weird. We didn't even meet for, like, months. So, you know, I would like to emphasize that I don't think the physical, you know, the physical thing is secondary, and you know, it's really mostly about obviously, like, a soul connection and finding that you're not having to force yourself to act like something just to impress the person. If you find yourself, you know, feeling that the other person needs you to be a certain way and you're not that way, then it's probably a good sign that you're not, you know, looking at the right person. And obviously she's an incredible person and it's beautiful, wonderful. How to deal with being hurt. You know, I think one of the best ways to deal with being hurt, I guess specifically in a relationship or in a friendship or anything like that, for me, is sort of divvying out responsibility where it actually should be. You know, we often like to go through phases of, like, grief when you've been hurt by someone. So you go through the phase where you're super pissed and everything's their fault. And then you're questioning it and it's like, it's all my fault. And then you you know, eventually get over it. So I think that in the end, you kind of have to look at what you did to contribute to this relationship not working out or to this friendship not working out, and then, like, also accept that not everything is your fault and that you can't, like, take on all the blame. So it's like everything's a two-way street when it comes to friendships and relationships. And once you realize that, you can kind of step out of a situation and be like, oh, I can move on. Like, I can learn from this and do something different in the future. And, you know, that was sort of like what I wrote our whole In Defense of a Genre record about. I think I've answered quite a few questions. So I'll probably do this every couple of days or every day if I have the time. We're rehearsing now. First show is June 6th in Dallas, and I'm super excited. And thanks for writing in your questions. Keep them coming all week and through the tour, and I'll keep doing this. So thank you. Bye.